chairman of today's proceedings, for those very kind words. Ms. Prabha Maharaj, Deputy Permanent Secretary of the Ministry of Public Administration. Ms. Jacqueline Johnson, Director of Scholarships and Advanced Training Division. Ms. Atiya Davis, representative from the Government Human Resource Services Limited, GHRS. Ms. Nadine Penny, representative of the National Scholar Alumni Association of Trinidad and Tobago. Representatives of the various public sector and state agencies, members of the media, and most important, all our outstanding scholars, your parents and guardians. A very good morning, a special good morning to you. Are you happy to be here this morning? It didn't sound like that earlier when I was listening. Are you happy to be here this morning? Yes? Does it sound so? And I think one of the things it tells us is that we have to find a way for you to enjoy returning to your country, to make your contribution. Today's 2012 Returning National Scholars Symposium and Career Fair is a major event in all ministries annual calendar. I'm glad to see many of you here representing the different agencies, public sector agencies, and so on. But very important to see so many of you as scholars here this morning. The interest groups that are essential to the success of the fair and the future success of all our scholars. I hope that you can all meet and mingle, ask some questions and set up interviews and appointments to explore all the many possibilities that I know will emerge from today's events. I want you to note that what we have here today, what you are participating in, and what we are emphasizing is a career fair. It is not a job fair. All of you returning scholars deserve to be employed and to find jobs. This is a basic need. However, we believe that we have started you on a more holistic journey. It is the start of your career. We have given you the initial hunger and some of the skills that will be your first step towards a lifelong commitment to a particular path of self-development. It is a path that you have chosen and we have supported. Getting a job is an important initiation into the world of work, but building a career is what we want you to do as an integral and important aspect of our investment in you. We want people who can build themselves and help to build our nation at the same time. We want people to eat, breathe, dream, sweat, and sleep what they do. You must have a passion for what you are doing. We want people who aspire. We want people who achieve. And who will continue to aspire and achieve as long as they live. That is what we want. I also want to add my hope that having received schooling, you will ensure that you get an education. I differentiate between the two. Schooling is an academic pursuit at various times of our lives. Education is a lifelong occupation and preoccupation with excellence. Education is a complete and all-round development of a human being. Educated people are disciplined, they're productive, and most of all, they are tolerant. Does it sound familiar to you? The watchwords of our nation? Educated people are not followers of fads and fashions. They see the big picture. They can think outside the box, and they can look objectively at situations and events. They take pride in themselves and their intellects. That is what I want from all of you scholars here today. By all means, look for the jobs, but even while doing so, think of the career. Think of what you want to devote your life to. Then use the job, use the career, use every opportunity you are afforded to get an education. The other point I want to stress to you is the difference between a job, and a profession. What we want from you and what we gave you scholarships for, and what we want to see as we change the architecture of the public service, is professionalism. That is what we are encouraging, and what this country needs from those people we fund and support. Yeah. The difference between a job and a profession is that when foreigner comes, you may find a typist, the laborer, the majority of workers, in fact, put down their tools and change roles. They may become fathers, mothers, liners, drinkers, talkers, drivers, whatever. But when you are professional, it is not so. A doctor, a lawyer, when he or she closes the office or puts away the scalpel or the stethoscope or leaves the court, they are still doctors and lawyers. They can change their clothes, but they cannot change what they do and who they are. For example, as Claude Goddard mentioned, I am a professional engineer, and you know, through politics, I temporarily give up teaching engineering for a career in politics. However, you would have heard Claude say this morning, and that's why I would like to use the example, being a government minister does not make me less of an engineer. Engineering is my profession. It continues to define not just who I am, but how I view and respond to events, even in politics. It remains constant, even as my circumstances and choices change. I want to go to tell you, just to share that experience. I've had the opportunity to serve as a director on some boards. And I have found that my background, that particular approach to what I do, has been able to add value as my contribution to, let's say, that board of directors. As the accountant would be able to take his approach and bring value to that board meeting, similar to the lawyer or even a medical doctor. And this is why it is so important that we must understand that we have to develop professionally. And therefore, this is the essence of professionalism. Whatever the time or place, whatever the occasion or event, a doctor is a doctor, a lawyer is a lawyer, a teacher is a teacher, an architect is an architect, and an engineer is an engineer. The doctor may not have his bag with him, the lawyer his briefcase, or the engineer his library, but they are all professionals wherever they are. That is what professionalism is about. You are your profession 24/7. More than that, professionals have a code of ethics which define their conduct, a body of learning which is specific to your profession, and a very special relationship with your clients, and if you are not self-employed, with your employers. You were not sent to universities and special schools for you to cease being professional when you close your office or jump into your cars. We expect professional behavior, dedication, and commitment to your profession, your client, your employer, and most important, your country. At the macro level, we call it a journey from gold to diamond. We are saying that our public service is now 50 years old, and the structure that it had and we use from the colonial days served its purpose. However, our strategy for national development has changed. It is one that takes us from a pyramid-shaped structure to a diamond-shaped structure. In the pyramid, you know, the pyramid is like that. A few people at the top lead and are responsible for the decision-making, and a whole lot of people at the broad base of that pyramid follow and they do the work. In the diamond-shaped structure, which is like this, is that we'll meet the challenges of the future, this diamond-shaped structure. Our structure is based on better service delivery, as the MC said this morning. Our strategy will produce goods and services from the government to all citizens, which will cost less and will be easier to obtain. Using modern technology, some services will be close as yourself. Our strategy will lead to a public service that is geared to the needs of its citizens, the people of our country. Our aim, as Mr. McKellar said this morning, is a citizen-centric society, one in which the citizen is the center and the circumference. Everything revolves around the needs of our citizens, and they are the hub and the wheel. That is what the strategy is. And therefore, when we look at that diamond shape, you will find the focus is on professionals and professionalism. Empowering our professionals for decision making and in order to participate in delivering this quality service to citizens of Trinidad and Tobago. We cannot achieve this goal, this vision, this brave new world without having a lot of you as professionals at both the management and the support level who can make this system work, who can find ways of making the strategy to come to life, to add value to it and to sustain it. When change takes place, unless you have people managing it properly, things will fall apart as soon as the first problem arises and people revert to their comfort zones. We need you, the young people here today, our young scholars, to use this opportunity as building blocks for your own careers and for your own country. Let me stress that you scholars are a fundamental part of our new strategy. Your scholars will take us from gold to diamond. You scholars will be our guides for the next 50 years of our national development, as Mr. McKellar mentioned. We have looked at what skills and competencies we need to make this nation a better nation, a more successful nation, and a more sustainable nation. We have identified young people who we believe have the ability and whose skills and competencies we can develop in a supportive educational environment and after graduation in an even more supportive work environment. However, at the micro level, each of you must make the journey from gold to diamond for yourself. You have to strive to continuously, during your entire lives, to make yourselves better human beings, to make yourselves more employable, to make your own prospects brighter and your own lives immeasurably more rewarding. That is my challenge to you. That is your nation's challenge to you. We can help, as we have already done. The Scholarship Division has nurtured and guided you along a particular path. But you have to think of where you are now, not as 100 meters, but as a marathon. We have brought you to the start. We have entered you into the race, but we are not going to declare you winners. You have to earn victory for yourself and by yourself. You earn your scholarship, and you will earn whatever you achieve and accomplish. Remember, too, that you have debts to pay, not just to the government, because in a way, that is a minor demand. The money spent on you, the time that was devoted to you, the attention given to you, will all be worth it if you pay off your debts to those who you really owe. You must pay off or try to pay off your debts to your parents or guardians. You have to pay off your debts to the communities in which you were raised. It takes more than parents. It takes a village to raise a child. You have to pay off your debt to your nation, not only your government, the entire nation that chose to invest in you instead of some other pressing need. I wonder if you have made a link when I talk about paying your debt off to your community. Is there a link to what the previous speaker spoke about? The representative from the Alumni Association, your communities? Giving back is what you have to start doing. Because as a professional, you will be able to show others how we are able to make that contribution. There are always more demands on a government than there are resources. And when we invest in you, it means someone else, some other priority, some other demand did not get those resources. We invest in you as a human resource. You have to demonstrate beyond a shadow of doubt that we need the right decision. Now I turn to the primary purpose of today's event. Part of our commitment to you was that upon completion of your academic program, we would assist in placing you into the world of work so that you can immediately begin applying your knowledge and gaining practical experience. This is an opportunity, hopefully one of several, that we and other organizations will make available to you. We have brought together a lot of potential employers, especially in the public sector, whose needs may match your skills, or who may see in you the kind of employee they can groom to eventually contribute to the ministry, the companies, or ministry's bottom line. In the end, if you cannot contribute to an organization's profitability, regardless of how that is measured, whether in prosperity or progress, there will be no place for you, not even in self-employment. Remember too, in the professional world, the increasing emphasis on value for money means that you are as good as your last job. If your last job is not at the highest level of achievement, if you do not go beyond the narrow parameters of the job description, if you do not add value or contribute meaningfully, you will always find the next job increasingly harder to get, even more difficult to hold. You can do it. You can achieve this. Do not underestimate the value of supporting each other right here in this room. So therefore, let me make a plug for the National Alumni Association of Philanthropy. Let us give them a round of applause. I hope that round of applause means that you will be joining that association. The association is proving to be an excellent organization for supporting, mentoring of all our returning scholars. Please utilize this support and encourage. Imagine yourselves 4 or 5 years from today as a member of this organization, mentoring future returning scholars to our mission. I want to thank all the prospective employers who are here today. We are glad to see that you want to invest in our young people. We can assure you that it is a safe investment. Gilt-edged, in fact. In a way, it is like a bond, which if you manage it right, it will mature in 5 to 10 years and provide you with a guaranteed income for the rest of the life of your enterprises, be they state, public, or private. We are here as honest brokers in this transaction. We want the best for both parties. We want win-win solutions. We want you to win and our scholars to win. And if you both win, we will have all won. Our government will have won, and our nation will have hit the jackpot. In closing, I want to commend our scholarships, training, and training division for the way they manage their mandate and the extent to which they go beyond the call of duty to provide competent, conscientious, and yet sympathetic support to their charges. A very under-resourced division, by the way. It takes me back to my childhood, my early childhood, when I started school. My parents always had someone older to look out for me. We, our scholarship division, particularly director, Ms. Johnson, looks out for her children and looks after them well. This fair today is a tribute to her vision, her dedication, and her willingness to go the extra mile. In fact, many of you last year would have recalled when we launched the SATA system, which is our technology driven, our use of technology for the offer of the service delivery element for scholarships. In addition, as you heard earlier, one of the initiatives undertaken by Mr. McKellar through the Public Service Transmission Division at the Ministry of Public Administration, through the Public Service Transmission Program, is the development of service charters for each service offered by the various government ministries and agencies, associated agencies. As the Deputy Permanent Secretary mentioned, Scholarship Division will be launching its service charter over the next month. It is important to note that this will be the first service charter for the public service of Trinidad and Tobago, ladies and gentlemen. And for that, I think they deserve a round of applause. This division is our flagship. I know it's not perfect. We still have its teething problems, and you are here to help us as we move this division forward to continuously improve its service delivery. It is, however, our flagship as we navigate towards the distant dream of a Trinidad and Tobago where it is easy to do business, where citizens are satisfied with the services government provides and feel that their needs are met, and where professionals in every sense of the word manage the affairs of this country. To you, scholars, in closing, may God continue to bless you and guide you through the development of your professional life. I pray that you will realize your dreams and will make your valued contribution to the development of our great nation of Trinidad and Tobago over the next 50 years. I thank you, ladies and gentlemen, and God bless each and every one of you.